Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. This morning, apologies have been received from Mercedes Villalba. Before we begin, can I remind those committee members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Our second item of business this morning is an evidence session on petition PE1490, control of wild goose numbers, which has been lodged by Patrick Krause on behalf of the Scottish Crofting Federation. This petition was referred to the committee following previous consideration by both the Public Petitions Committee and the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee in Session 4, and the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee in Session 5. The petition calls on the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to address the problems created by increasing populations of wild geese in crofting areas as a matter of priority, reassesses its decision to stop funding existing goose management programme and assign additional resources to crop protection and adaptive management programmes to ensure this threat to the future of crofting is averted. And I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting this morning petitioner Patrick Krause, and I hope I've pronounced your surname correctly. As this is the committee's first consideration of petition, I would invite you to make an opening statement.
That's great. Thank you very much, and thank you very much, everyone, for allowing me to come in and support the petition. We've had the petition in existence for a number of years now. It was lodged in 2013. And I would argue that we need to keep it live because things haven't got any better. And I know that some of you that are here, obviously your constituents are saying the same thing to you. So in 2013, across the crofting counties, they estimated there were about 8,000 greylag geese. So these are the Icelandic greylags. In Uist alone now, there are 8,000 Icelandic greylag geese, and they're resident now. They were at one time just passing through, but they've become resident birds now, so they're a problem throughout the year. Back in 2012, NatureScot, or it was SNH at the time, established some adaptive management projects. And adaptive management means that you do a bit of culling and then you take counts, and then you do a bit of culling and then you take counts. And it sounds like a very sensible way of doing it, but after 5 years of a very successful pilot, they decided to not continue with this. And I can never understand the logic of that. Surely that's what a pilot is you test something, and if it works, then you do it. Whereas they tested it, it worked, so they didn't do it. So every year after they stopped the adaptive management schemes, the budget reduced. So it went down from just under 50,000 for the whole of the Crofting Islands. So that's Tyree and Cole, the Uists, and Lewis and Harris, and Orkney. And so there was just below 50,000 that was used for the adaptive management projects. And this was reduced every year until finally they decided in 2021 to not have any funding go to the control of geese at all, and that NatureScot's role would simply be advisory. Now, I just don't understand the logic of this whatsoever, you know, because there didn't seem to be any plan in place for continuing the control. And so we went and had a meeting with the minister and expressed our extreme concerns about this, because it's at the point where crofters are giving up crofting because of the goose problem. You know, and this isn't an exaggeration, you know, that we use things like this in the press, and we say, you know, the geese are protected and crofters aren't, and, you know, crofters are an endangered species now and so on. But the point is that in these islands, particularly Uist and Tyree, we have this really unique maca environment. And we have a lot of crops that are used, land races that are traditional crops that you don't find anywhere else, and the seed is only available on the islands. And anyway, so the minister then announced that she was going to put 50,000 or up to 50,000 towards goose management in the crofting areas. And in her press release, she acknowledged that the Maka is a very important environmental area and so on. And yet most of that 50,000 actually goes to Orkney. And Orkney doesn't have this same Maka environment. And I'm certainly not knocking Orkney. Orkney has got a really big problem with greylags as well. So Orkney has in the region of 21,000 birds. And Lewis and the US have about 8,000 birds and Tyrese in the same sort of area. And so the Western Isles are getting 6,000 to for the islands to this is per island to control this. Now, do tell me to shut up when I have to shut up, but I've only got a couple of minutes more. In Orkney, they're trialling a thing called corralling, where they take the birds, where they round the birds up. So canoeists round molting birds up, and molting birds can't fly. And so they round them up into estuaries, and then qualified people have to catch them and administer a lethal drug to kill them. So this works out at about £25 per bird. And you know, we've in the US and Lewis, we've had a shooting program, and it costs about £8 per bird. So again, I'm sort of quite surprised at the logic of this, you know, that Nature Scott has let a situation get completely out of hand to the point that they're having to use corralling, which, I mean, no lethal method is nice, and the public perception of it, of course, isn't nice. And I have to add that crofters and the marksmen that do this work really don't like it, you know. So, but it's something that we have to do, because keeping the birds down to a tolerable level is the only way that we're going to manage this. And the minister in her interview, she said that we expect crofters and geese to be able to live alongside each other. And we agree with this, but it will only work when they're manageable numbers. So about 5 years ago, it was estimated that in Uist is a good example, that they could tolerate 2,500 birds. The adaptive management scheme actually got this figure down to 4,000, and so we were complaining then, but there's 8,000 now. So £6,000 isn't going to even make a dent in this at all. You know, just to bring them down to 4,000, shooting them, we're going to need 32,000. Sorry to throw all these figures at you. I'm sure Spice will have all the figures anyway. But it's just to get an idea of proportions. You know, that we need about 32,000 to bring the numbers down to the very threshold of tolerability, and we've only got 6,000. So I would urge you, please, to keep the petition going, particularly because this year Nature Scott carry out their 5-yearly review of the management programme. So it's very timely to keep the petition going, if you would. We're not asking for eradication of the birds. We're just asking for them to be reduced to a manageable level. So thank you very much for hearing my argument.
Thank you very much, Patrick. That's certainly given us lots of food for thought. And I know that there will be, if we look back, there's plenty of briefings and committee papers which will inform us a lot of the background, but there is a lot of questions I'm quite sure members have got. I've got one in particular. You suggest that there's about 5,500 birds too many in use at the moment, which is very concerning. And if you're talking about £25 a head for humane slaughter, if you like. That just seems completely unreasonable. You also touched on there's now resident birds. Why is there now resident? What's happened to change that? So rather than them being visitors, that they're there full time. What's happened and what's changed that these birds are now staying?
Yeah. I mean, that's a really interesting point, because I think most people put this down to climate change, and whether it's long-term climate change or whether we're just going through a phase where it's been warmer, that's all part of the argument. But the fact is that the climate has changed such that the birds are finding that the environment is suitable for them year round now, so they stay. If I could just answer the first bit as well, please. The other thing that I meant to say was that this corralling involves using specialist organisations. So, as well as paying just over three times the amount per bird to cull them, the money's going to specialist organisations, so it goes out of the area. And Nature Scot have said that they want to see sustainability in this. And at least if we're using public money and it's going to marksmen to keep the numbers down by shooting, then at least the money stays in the local economy.
Thank you. We've got quite a few members. Jim Fairley's desperate to come in on one of your comments, and I'll move to Alistair Allen.
Patrick, thanks very much for coming in. This is fascinating. And from a farming perspective, I absolutely get the reasons why you need to control numbers. The corralling bit absolutely blew my mind. I didn't realise it was happening, that we're paying people to go out and poison them. What happens to the carcasses after they're poisoned? I presume they get dumped.
They get dumped, yeah.
Yeah. It kind of takes me on to the whole point that we were talking about beforehand. I'd like to ask a couple of questions, and Alistair will probably come in and mop up what I miss. I see this as an opportunity in terms of the ability to be able to use goose meat as a product. So can you tell me, first of all, why there's no recreational shooting? Because I don't understand why we need to pay people to go and shoot geese. Because people will pay to go out and shoot. It gives us a good quality source of protein. Why do we need government intervention at all? Why has this not become a micro-business for the places where goose numbers are large? Because the marketing opportunities, as far as I can see, would be immense.
That's a really good point, and it does seem logical. And I think that's been part of the problem, is that Nature Scot have assumed that it can be self-funding. But I think the reason it's not is mainly because there are just too many birds, you know. And so there's a limited market for what you can do with goose meat, and the business that was dealing with this had a license, and then there was a mess up with the relicensing, which was it was Nature Scot's fault. They'd forgotten to ask the European Union for a license, and so it interrupted.
Need to be able to sell goose meat. Let's clear that one up first. Why do they need a license to sell goose meat?
Yeah, I'm not sure, but we do have to have a license to sell goose meat.
Okay.
But it is licensed now, and you know, so that's good. And I know of one business that is starting to use goose meat, and doing things like making salami from it and so on. But it's a limited market, and the numbers are just so huge that a small business can't deal with this.
Is it a limited market in the sense that it's only ever been used or exposed in a very limited marketplace, i.e. is it only to be sold in the Western Isles? If you were to roll this out as the same as they did with the Orkney Gold beef, to me, the marketing opportunity for big supermarkets at a time where we've got potentially food shortages, we're talking about food shortages, we want to have a resilient food and drink sector.
Yeah.
I just don't understand why this product can't be sold right across the UK.
Yeah.
With proper marketing being done on it.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it could. And I think it's the differential between the existing numbers and the numbers of the market, the number of businesses that are trying to access the market. You know, the market's too small and the numbers of geese are too big at the moment. And, you know, anything like this, it takes time to open a market up. You know, in all of the initiatives that we have, you know, like Scotch Lamb and Orkney Gold and so on and so on, it takes a long time to establish that market, and it takes a lot of money to get a market like that going because of the advertising and promotion and so on.
Better way of spending money than poisoning geese and sticking them in a hole.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
I'll leave it there, convener. Thank
agree.
You.
Yeah, that is a whole line of question we could enter. It just brought me in mind of my late dear friend Alec Ferguson, who was the convener of this committee some years ago. And I remember the dread on his face when it was geese or deer. And I think in a lot of what you're saying, you could replace the word goose by deer, and we're still, there's opportunities there. Just before we move on to Alistair, a really quick one. Is the fact that you need a licence to sell geese, is that as a consequence of there being a control system in place that's funded, or is this something that's general across the whole of Scotland? Is it specific to the Isles?
No, it's a general thing. My understanding is that it's a European licence that we have to have.
Okay.
To sell the meat from a species that has a restriction upon it. I think that's the point. You know, so even though there's a general license now to shoot greylag geese, all geese are controlled in some way.
Okay, thank you. That's useful. Alistair Allen, and then Arian Burgess.
Thank you very much. I declare not so much an interest as an appreciation of what you're saying. Given that I live in a place where sometimes I look out my window and feel like I'm in a Hitchcock film, at the number of greylag geese landing around me. I wonder if you could maybe just explain a bit more to the committee about why this is a particular problem in areas which are crofting areas. I mean, not everyone maybe appreciates the degree to which crofters are part-time agriculture and the pressures on their time. And I mean, can you say something about the scale of the task that would face either a crofter or a village in trying to deal on this without external assistance?
Yeah. It's quite a complex issue, as you know. And part of the problem is that shooting isn't done as much. So actually going back to what you said as well, that, you know, there is sport shooting and crofting. Most crofters in the Western Isles are tenants, and so the landlords retain the shooting rights, and so shooting geese is a business for the landlords, and again, they just don't have the numbers of shooters, and crofters on the whole don't shoot. It's something that has changed over generations. You know, in the past, it was fairly usual for crofters to shoot whatever they could for the pot, and that has gradually diminished, and so a lot of crofters don't have guns anymore. It's also very difficult to shoot geese, you know, which is why it's a sport and why people do it as a sport, because it is actually very difficult to shoot geese. The marksmen have all said that over the years it's getting more and more difficult because geese are quite clever, and, you know, to the point of literally recognising the marksman's car and so moving on, you know, as he or she comes down the hill, the geese take off because they know who it is. And it is difficult. But there are crofters. There are some crofters that are shooting, and so, like in Lewis, for example, the local goose management group pays for the ammunition, but people are actually coming out as volunteers and shooting, and, you know, so you know, there's a gathering of people at this time of year to go out and do some shooting. But I think the answer I can give to almost any question is that the problem is that we're completely overrun. The numbers are just way too high. So, that really is the stem of the problem. You know, if we'd controlled them from 5 years ago or 7 years ago, when we had the numbers at a more practical level, we wouldn't be in this situation. And it's just gone completely out of hand now.
On your point about cars, I have had people put to me that geese can recognise number plates. But, I mean, the serious point in that is that the one you've just made, which is that there is a dramatic change in the number of grey lag geese landing on people's crofts. Again, I wonder if you could maybe just say a bit, though, about what it is grey lag geese do when they land on a croft.
Well, they're grazers, for one thing. So you know, obviously, crofters are livestock keepers on the whole. And so this relationship between the cattle grazing the maca and, you know, that increases the biodiversity. And if the cattle can't graze because the geese have already got the fresh grass, and the trouble is that they don't just graze the grass, they completely destroy it. You know, they've got quite big feet, geese, so they're plodding about, flattening the grass, and they can produce an amazing amount of dung themselves. And cattle won't go and graze where geese have messed it. So you know, people are literally finding a field that they were using yesterday they can't use the next day, because during the early hours a flock has come down and completely taken the field out of use. So you know, the consequences are huge. You know, the crofter thinks that he's got this amount of grazing for this number of animals, and then suddenly it's halved, literally overnight. And he's got to either buy feed in or he's got to start selling animals quick.
See, this is an example of an issue where agriculture and environmentalists are actually on the same side. You've described a situation about the Machar landscape and the need for that landscape to be grazed, to be a habitat. Is there a kind of common cause here?
There's a common cause. RSPB, for example, are probably the biggest environmental organisation and have the most concern about the welfare of the birds, of course. But they agree with us. And they in fact, ran a project themselves to bring the goose numbers down. And this whole point about the environment and this close relationship between the way crofters manage the land and the fact that it enhances the environment. You know, not that long ago, crofters and the way crofters manage the land was sort of looked on as a bit old-fashioned and, you know, oh, well, that will change, you know, they'll catch up. And of course, now, you know, particularly all this, the emphasis on the twin emergencies of climate change and biodiversity loss and the fact that we hosted the COP, you know, there's very much a spotlight on the environment now, quite right, of course. And you know, I believe that the way crofters have been managing the land is now being recognised as a sustainable way forward. And, you know, we will lose these old varieties of grain, for example, because the seed is only produced on the islands. And once it's gone, it's gone.
Thank you.
Just before we move on to Anna, are you aware of any biodiversity research that's been done on the island? So the emphasis in this petition has been about protecting livelihoods, really, with the grazing and the sustainability of agriculture. You know, the other direction to take it, as you've clearly set out, is about the marker and whatever, but the biodiversity loss, when you move from a sustainable number of geese off, and you've got twice the number or three times more geese than even the, you know, agriculture can deal with, never mind looking at biodiversity. Has there been any work being done to look at the biodiversity loss
attributed to?
There has been some. I mean, I would argue not enough, and that surely this is something that we employ Nature Scot to do. You know, they've got the researchers, so you know, they could be producing the evidence and showing, yes, geese impact on the environment.
Anna.
Thanks, Convener. And hello, Patrick.
Hello.
Thanks so much for coming to give evidence today. And I just really appreciate what you've said up to this point. And I think it is a very interesting conversation that Jim Fairley has initiated around feeding people. And so I'm a regional MSP, so I cover most of the areas and issues, the areas where geese are an issue. And it's interesting because I live in Murray, where geese are shot on a nature reserve, and the local people don't want that to happen. And so, you know, and people, as Jim said, people pay to come and do that shooting, and they come from Europe to do that at times. So there's something here that we do need to look at overall. So I've got a few questions. You've answered actually quite a few of mine. In terms of the... So you were saying that so there's now £50,000 back, is that right? That's been reintroduced, but it's been split, and Orkney gets the most because of the way in which they're culling the geese.
Yeah, I think it's mainly due to the fact that they're trialling the corralling. I also wonder how much it's well. Also, Orkney have got three times the number of birds.
Yeah.
You know, so you know they've got three times the problem, so I can understand that as well. And I don't know whether there's any fact in that there is definitely more money spent on areas that are producing commercial grain. You know, so in the US, crofters tend to be just producing animals and small amounts of traditional grains. So it's a very small enterprise, you know, whereas Orkney, of course, is producing, you know, a commercial beef product,
right,
and producing a lot of grain for feed.
Yeah.
So I don't know how much that affects, you know, decisions that are made on where the money is going to be spent. I mean, sorry to go on. I'm answering more than you asked. But, it can't help but strike you that for the other protected species, which tend to affect islands like Isla. Now, Isla, of course, produces whiskey. Whiskey is a commercial success story for Scotland. And they are a different goose that is the problem, and they're more strictly controlled. And so farmers are paid compensation. So the point I'm trying to make is that the budget for the crofting areas is 50,000, and the budget for the other agricultural commercial areas that have goose problems is 1.1 million. And I know Nature Scot would probably argue that it's because they are a more protected species, but I just ask the question, is the fact that there are commercial interests here, does that play a part in how they decide to spend the budget?
Thank you for that. And you're welcome to expand your answers beyond my questions. So I would be interested in hearing what would be proportionate, reasonable for a quota on the amount of geese, greylag geese, let's stick with that, that could be culled each year, do you think?
Well, as I said in the beginning, in Uist, for an example, you know, the crofters, you know, there was a lot of work done on this in the adaptive management program. So you know, it was a really useful program, and they estimated that in Uist, if they had 2,500 birds, then they can live happily alongside each other, and that sort of proportion would probably be for all of the crofting areas. If you can bring them down, I can remember a time probably around the petition and pre-petition where Orkney was only just starting to feel that geese were a problem. People were starting to say, yeah, is a bit of a problem. Now it's completely out of hand. And Orkney farmers are giving up. You know, and we had the National Goose Forum the other day, and the Orcadian representative said that he personally knows of farmers that are giving up farming in Orkney because of the geese.
So you described at the beginning the process that Nature Scot went through over a period of time, and then at some point, after 5 years, they stopped. And so now we've got this, you know, increase of birds. And we want to get to, so we're using the example of Uist, so we want to get to 2,500 birds. What would we do? How many years would that take over time to get to that place, that number?
Yeah. I think the answer is that we really need to get the numbers down as soon as we possibly can. And I'm not an expert on culling geese, so I don't know what is realistic, you know, whether we can reduce them by 2,000 every year, you know, until we get to that sort of figure, or whether you know, if we made a bigger effort, whether we could reduce more of them per year, say 3,000 a year. It's going to take a few years to get the numbers down again.
And then another question I have is about the ammunition used for shooting. So I'm aware that there's different kinds. And obviously, if we were going in the trajectory that Jim has introduced, which is food, then and I know that RSPB are keen to see lead ammunition not being used. So
Yeah. Have
you got any thoughts on that?
Not really. I'm not that technical. I don't shoot personally, so I can understand the need to not use lead if we're going to use the meat for going into the human food chain. You know, of course. My understanding is that the stainless steel shot costs more, so it just means that the costs are going to go up a bit. But it's a proportional thing. You know, so if it means you can then start using the meat. Then it makes sense to pay that bit more for steel shot.
Thank you. I think Jim, yep. Jim Fairley making the comment that I think there's the direction of travel is away from lead shot. That's certainly our understanding. I'm going to move to Rachel Hamilton, then Jenny Minto.
Obviously, with the pressures on food security and what you said about, you know, some of the traditional barley and cereal crops that are being grown in the islands, do you not think that this is actually should be considered as an emergency by this government?
Absolutely. Yeah, I can only agree with you. This is an emergency. We're going to see people that can produce food going out of business, you know, quite quickly from this, I think.
And you mentioned that crofters are giving up. What do crofters do, and what happens to the land if they're not managing the land?
It lies unused, unfortunately. So there are, you know, quite a lot of examples of crofts just lying neglected now.
Okay.
And it's not just entirely because of the geese. There's a problem with neglected crofts anyway.
Okay, and lastly, Nature Scot say that they want a balance between the controlling the geese and mitigating the impacts on agricultural production. Do you have any examples, Patrick, of what Nature Scot would consider if, for example, a crop had been trampled by geese, a crofter had to then pay for more seed to resow and go through the whole process again and, in fact, lose that crop potentially? What do you think that they consider a balance, and do you consider that crofters would be content with compensation because they have to put up with the geese?
I think that it's not really about compensation, to be quite honest. I don't want to digress into the white-tailed sea eagle, but the argument has been the same there. You know, that crofters have said that we need to protect our crops from eagles and geese, and they're asked, is this a compensation thing? And throughout, they've always said this isn't about compensation. You know, we don't grow crops to feed geese. We grow crops because we grow cattle, and that's what we're trying to do. And we produce some of the best cattle and the best beef that's available. We have the best environment to do it. We have this very unique ecosystem going. So destroying the ecosystem and just saying, well, okay, there's some money, isn't the answer. You know, it's about maintaining the balance. And in the national goose policy, there are three sort of primary pillars, and it's the whole policy is based on conservation of the species, on crop protection, and on value for money, because it's public money, and it's just completely out of balance. You know, there's been too much emphasis on the conservation, and you know, I and the SCF and Crofters aren't anti-conservation at all. Quite the opposite, in fact. But the emphasis has been too much on conservation of species, and crop protection always seems to take the last consideration. So they'll look at conservation and they'll look at value for public money. I have to say, I don't think they look at value for public money very well in some of the examples I've given. And crop protection always seems to end up last.
OK, thank you.
Jenny.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Patrick Crousey, for coming today. I represent Argyll and Bute, so I recognise the goose issue on a number of the islands I represent. I think as well, Isla, yes, you're correct, does whisky. It's also home to about 40,000 over the winter barnacles and Greenland white-fronted, and of course farmers and, very importantly, crofters as well. So it's the whole range of users. I want to maybe kind of go off on a slight tangent, perhaps. I'm certainly aware, driving around Argyll and Bute, there's a vast increase in Canadian goose numbers as well. And I'm interested, given the increase that there's been in the grey lag geese since the petition was first brought in, how other things have changed around goose numbers. And I'm thinking specifically of the Canadian ones, which are not indigenous species to here.
I don't know about the Canadians on the Western Isles, but I know that barnacles are, you know, the Greenland barnacle, probably in the last 5 years, I think. You know, that's the interesting thing with these, is that the numbers change very quickly. So 5 years ago, barnacles probably weren't being considered much of a pest at all, and now they're a very big pest. So I know we keep going on about the grey lags, and again, it's just, as I said, because of the huge numbers involved, but barnacles are becoming a serious problem as well.
Thank you. And you've, in some of your earlier answers, you've talked about the five-year review that's coming up. Can I ask how you plan to get involved with that, or what conversations you've had with Nature Scot to date?
Yeah, they haven't actually started the review. So at the National Goose Forum, so we attend the National Goose Forum, so they said they'll be launching the new review fairly shortly, and we'll be contacting all the stakeholders and asking for evidence and opinion, and I'll be lobbying you people, I'm afraid, and asking for your support.
Okay, thank you.
Members, unfortunately, we're running tight of time, but I'm going to go to Beatrice Wishart and then Karen Adam.
Yeah, it's just one quick question to Patrick, and it's good to see you here today in person. I noticed from a report on the BBC from 3 years ago that meat from wild geese shot in Orkney was to go on sale across Scotland for the first time. I wonder if you had any knowledge of how that went.
I don't. I think it's been fairly successful, but again, my understanding is that it's all very, very small scale, you know, and can't address the problem. And Nature Scott admit that selling meat isn't going to answer the problem that we have at the moment. You know, as Jim was saying, you know, longer term, you know, there's all sorts of potential, but right now we're completely swamped. And small amounts of meat being sold doesn't really make any difference at all.
So would you describe it as a crisis?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Karen.
Thank you, Convener. And good morning, Patrick. I know that this issue is very specific. You know, it's a certain species of bird and the landscape, biodiversity is very specific to the area. But have you looked across the world to see if there are any similar circumstances in regards to solutions for this and best practice? Mm-hmm. I recognise that the petition is calling, you know, on us to help. But oftentimes, you know, it's helpful if you have anything in mind yourself for a solution.
Yeah. Nature Scott have partners in other countries that they talk to about goose management, but it's more from a conservation aspect. So I personally don't really know that much about goose management as management of a pest in other countries. I would say that on the geographic limitations in Scotland, those areas are expanding really rapidly, and so Shetland now is starting to see a goose problem. You know, even Beatrice will know this. You know, but even in the last 5 years, say, probably even less, it's turned from Shetlanders being able to look at the problems elsewhere in Scotland with sympathy to now getting up in the morning and seeing the geese all over their land as well. And, you know, I know we do talk about the Western Isles a lot. You know, this is where the problem really started. So, but it is spreading. So it's right across the Northern Isles now and the mainland. You know, so in Loch Abber and so on, there are problems very similar. They just don't have the numbers yet, but they're coming.
Thank you. And very, very, very finally.
Sorry, I could talk to you all day. Very, very quickly. There are tensions between landowners and tenant sheep farmers in terms of grazing deer. And there is an agreement where landowners have to control certain numbers of deer. What responsibility do landowners have in protecting the grazing and the cropping of tenant crofters as part of their responsibility as a landowner?
They don't have any legal responsibility to protect crofters' crops. Some landlords are quite good. So Storris Ewis, for example, which is a community landlord, are very involved in the management of geese, and the relationship between the crofters and the community landlords all across actually is very good. So private landlords, you know, I'm not here to knock private landlords at all, you know, but they have other business to attend to, and you know, maintaining numbers of geese like maintaining numbers of deer is part of their business plan.
But it's not sufficient at the moment?
No, not at all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick, and thank you very much for your informative and measured contribution supporting your petition. I found that fascinating this morning, and once again, probably just raised more questions in members' minds than answered them. Our paper members set out suggestions for next steps. I propose that we do move to continue the petition and look at this further. And I would suggest we'd write to the Scottish Government and Nature Scott for an update on the adaptive goose management projects and request details of the timetable and likely scope, given that
that it's almost 10 years since the petition was first raised, and in light of the further evidence we've had today of the potential impact on biodiversity, the change in the living patterns or the habitat of the geese, I think we also need to ensure that we're aware of what the scope of the review will be, given the changes in circumstances. And then I would propose that we consider the matter again on receipt of a response from the Scottish Government. Are members agreed? Thank you. We're now going to have a brief suspension. I suggest we suspend until 10:25. And we'll move on to the agenda item on Ukraine. Thank you.
Our third item of business today is an evidence session on the impact of the Russian invasion of Ukraine on food supply chains in Scotland. And I welcome to the meeting our panellists who are contributing remotely. We have Elspeth MacDonald, the Chief Executive Officer from the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, Professor Alan Matthews, the Professor Emerite of European Agriculture Policy at Trinity College Dublin, Dr Mike Rivington, the Land Use Systems Modeller from the James Hutton Institute, Stephen Thompson, the Agricultural Economist from Scottish Rural College, and Scott Water, Scott Walker, the Chief Executive Officer of National Farmers Union of Scotland. We're not going to take opening statements. We're going to move straight to questions. And I'll kick off. I just want to go around the panel and ask how Scotland's food production and sectors are being directly affected by the Russian invasion. And I would like to ask you to what extent the impacts are thought to be a direct result of the invasion or compounding existing challenges. And we'll start with the top left on my screen, which is Scott Walker, please.
Thank you very much, convener. You're quite right to say that a lot of the problems we're currently facing existed before the war in Ukraine. So what the war in Ukraine is doing is compounding a lot of existing issues that already happened in the food chain. The big impact of the war in Ukraine, I suppose I could boil down to two issues to simplify it, is the impact on feed prices and the impact on fuel prices. And if I explain about the impact on fuel prices first, because that, I think, is the fundamental cause to the problems that we'll see in the supply chain, and which will ultimately, I think, unless there is intervention, lead to a reduction in productive capacity here in Scotland, both at the farm level and also potentially in the production level in the manufacturing sectors. So in essence, because of the rise in gas prices, what you've seen is a very substantial increase, a doubling and trebling in some cases, in fertiliser prices. And ultimately, fertiliser is what underpins the productive capacity of agriculture. So what we see immediately is, if I use the poultry sectors and the pig sectors as an example, they've had an immediate increase both in their fuel costs and also in their feed costs, which has exacerbated, which was already a loss-making situation in the pig sector, even further. So just now, every pig producer in Scotland will be losing around £50 on every pig that they sell, which is already leading to a contraction in the pig supplies coming from Scottish farms and jeopardising the processing sector in Scotland. We see the same issues, without going into the detailed figures, both in the poultry and egg sector just now, which fundamentally undermines our ability to produce. If I just very briefly, then allow others to speak, if I look at the livestock sector, because of the long production cycles in livestock, in essence, cows have been put to the bull and calves already in production, those animals are going to come through. But what individuals in that sector are looking at now is what's going to happen about the production of winter keep this year. And if they don't use the fertiliser, as appears to be the case from the anecdotal evidence we're getting back from farmers, there'll be less winter keep, and therefore at the back end, we could see quite a sizeable number of cattle being reduced in Scotland.
Thank you. Just before I move on to other panel members, Scott, you talked about decisions that farmers are taking just now. Is there any irreversible consequences of decisions that have been taken now? So you talked about the bull being put out or potentially less ground being put down for wheat or barley or re-sown as grass. Do you see any evidence that there's irreversible impacts on production towards the end of the year because of decisions that are taken now?
Yeah, it's a timing thing. So what we're seeing just now is, I use the pig sector again as the example just now. So the pig sector is contracting at this moment in time. I've spoken to pig farmers who are reducing the size of the herd and some individual pig farmers who are in the process of winding down the business and going out of business during the next few months. That will ultimately lead to less pigs coming to market. So that will be felt during the course of this year. In terms of eggs, what you have is, call it a 16-week cycle there for eggs. So if the birds are there just now, they'll be seen through to the end. But what farmers are doing is looking at putting less birds in the future, or reducing the number of hen houses that they're actually occupying. So they'll be the immediate effects that we'll see. I think in terms of grain and livestock, what you're going to see is the effects towards the end of this year, but more likely coming to take into impact in 2023 and 2024.
Thank you.
And sorry, just last thing, sorry, just to add to that. My big concern is that the retail sector hasn't woken up to the fact of securing domestic supply and production here. So we're not really seeing the signals for many of those produce to avert those decisions. So confidence is very low just now in the farming sector.
Thank you. I'm sure we'll come back to that topic and further questioning. Can I now move to Professor Alan Matthews, please?
Well, again, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm obviously the outsider on this panel, and what Scott has said seems to make a lot of sense to me. What I would perhaps nuance slightly is that the picture is not a dark one overall. So it's clear that different sectors within farming will be affected differently. So I would see, there has been a dramatic increase in production costs, fuel, fertilizer and so on. But of course, there's also been a dramatic increase in some producer prices, in particular for wheat and other grains. So arable farmers, I think, will look forward to quite a profitable season. I think pasture-based livestock farming, we see milk prices rising, which at least partially will compensate for the higher production costs. So the focus is very much on the animal feed and the intensive agricultural sectors, as Scott has highlighted. But that, of course, is just a part of the overall Scottish agricultural sector. And I suppose just to bear in mind that there are, I suppose, as you as politicians have to weigh up these conflicting objectives, there are these broader issues of how to address the impact of higher grain prices on global food security, not just in Ukraine itself, but also in low-income countries that are highly dependent on food imports. And also how to maybe use this opportunity to progress what I know is Scotland's very ambitious goals in the green transition. So both in terms of reducing fossil fuel dependence in agriculture and also encouraging changes in consumer purchasing and eating habits. Thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. Mike Rivington, please.
Good morning. Thanks very much, Convener. I'd just like to sort of point out that something that Professor Matthews was saying is actually, I think there may be winners and losers in this situation, in that there are some people who have taken up the sort of approaches towards agroecological production systems and have lower dependence on fertilizers, and therefore a little bit independent from the impacts on fertilizer costs, but could also then benefit from the higher grain prices. And the benefits of the agroecological approaches that some farmers are practicing is that they also then also have net zero target benefits and biodiversity target benefits. So I think what we're likely to see is a range of impacts, and actually what this situation may well be is an opportunity to support the transitions that the Scottish Government are working towards more environmentally forms of farming as well. So from my perspective, whilst there's obviously some very severe impacts across some parts of the food production sectors, that is also an opportunity as well. Thank you.
And finally, in this section, Steve Thompson, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I would like to thank some of my colleagues across SEC Consulting for feeding some of the information in. I suppose from the farming perspective, a lot of this is to do with whether or not you have pre-purchased fertiliser. And an awful lot of the cropping sector will have forward contracts and will already have stock of fertiliser, less so in the livestock sector. And the same goes for feed. So those producers that are locked into a contract, or those contracts are probably ending in spring, and they're suddenly faced with very sharp rises in feed prices and fertiliser prices. And those are the things that will dramatically impact on production decisions. And just reiterating what Scott was saying, those decisions are already in situ. So the anecdotal evidence that we're hearing are that people are using the very high cow prices just now and actually probably dispersing of some of their animals that aren't producing well, or perhaps actually making the decision, as Scott suggested, not to put cows back to the bull this year and actually to sell cows in the back end. Now, these are real decisions. These are things that are happening on the ground, and these are things that will actually ultimately impact on the processing sector and the downstream sector, and also upstream in terms of the supply side. So it's not just affecting farmers, it can actually have long-term impacts across the wider population. And then you think about the whole thing about consumer prices, and we're seeing inflation just continuing to rise. And we forget that quite a few of our products from the farming sector are quite elastic. That is, a small price increase leads to a large decrease in consumption. And we're yet to see that. So we're continuing to see the impact of COVID in terms of food sector, and the fact that quite a lot of us are still working remotely, although I'm in an office. And that whole sector is not really back to normal. So it's right what you said at the start, this whole thing of partly to do with EU exit, partly to do with COVID, but an awful lot of the decisions just now are to do with price increases.
Thank you. And Elspeth, you don't escape. I've got a question specifically for you. Can you maybe set out what the Scottish Fishermen's Federation's views are on the impact of the Scottish Government's withdrawal from engagement with the Russian Federation with regards to international fisheries negotiations?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee today. There's certainly an indirect impact on fishing, as well as some of the direct impacts in terms of things like fuel prices that the other contributors have spoken about. But the exclusion of Russia from some of the international fisheries negotiations is broadly supported. And it will have, I think, a differential impact on different parts of our fisheries. I think on our shell fisheries and our demersal fisheries, that won't have such an impact, but it will be significant in terms of some of our pelagic stocks, so things like our mackerel stock, where Russia is one of the partners in what's called the coastal state negotiations. And there are discussions underway at the moment about finding new sharing arrangements for our mackerel stocks, which are technical, and I won't go into all the detail of it here. And Russia are excluded from these talks, but there is support in the Scottish industry that it is right that Russia be excluded from these talks. Although we, of course, recognise that, you know, it will have implications for the pace at which the talks can progress. But I think too, in the same way as my sort of terrestrial counterparts on the panel have been talking about the some of the direct impacts of the war in Ukraine. Certainly the impacts of fuel costs on our industry are significant. Impacts on profitability. I think echoing some of the comments that Scott Walker made about parts of the industry already being vulnerable, and that being exacerbated by what we're seeing now in terms of fuel costs. But also, I think it's worth mentioning, too, the importance of Ukraine as a market for some of our product. And again, very important for our mackerel industry, where in excess of 20% of Scottish mackerel exports would have gone to Ukraine before the war. And I think as far as the Shetland fleet was concerned, that would be around the 30% mark. So now, obviously, that industry has to find new markets for a significant proportion of its production.
Thank you very much. I'll move to Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Of course, we know we really are facing a challenging time in regards to our labour and workers across the fishing and agricultural industries. The impact has been challenging, to put it mildly. Can I ask what impact the war in Ukraine has had on this issue, and if we are looking at a more complex situation now that we may need to incorporate into ongoing solution finding? Can I start with Elspeth, please?
I come back to the point I made about the export of our mackerel to Russia. I mean, that was a very direct, to Ukraine. That was a very immediate impact. Scotland used to export a lot of mackerel to Russia. When Russia invaded Crimea in 2014, there were sanctions put in place there and that trade stopped. And since then, a significant proportion of our mackerel product has gone to Ukraine. Obviously, there is still a demand in Ukraine. People there, despite the terrible circumstances that they're in, they obviously still need to eat, but there are real practical problems in terms of getting product there, and practical problems for these companies there in terms of distribution and paying for it. So I think there's, you know, the pelagic sector has had to adjust quickly to try to find some new markets for that product. I think what the situation in Ukraine has shown is just how vulnerable our industry is to these sorts of geopolitical shocks, whether that is as a consequence of the huge increases we've seen in fuel prices and the direct impact that is having on parts of our fleet. I think it's that vulnerability to those external factors that you have no control over, I think, really makes us focus much more on the importance of our domestic food security and ensuring that we've got both short and long-term policies in place to ensure that we are able to support our domestic food production. And I think there's much that we would see both in the short and the long term that we think would be helpful in terms of how we can do that to make sure that we continue to have our ability to produce food domestically and that we can support our domestic food security.
Thank you. Could I go to Scott Walker, please? And can I ask that what are the implications for seasonal, for farmers looking for seasonal workers? And is there any implications for Ukrainian workers that we have here already?
Yes, thank you. If I just start off with just the Ukrainian workers, many farms in Scotland would have had a lot of Ukrainian workers in the past, predominantly softfruit, field vegetable sector. And I know of some farms in Scotland where that would have been up to above 80% of their workforce. Now, first and foremost, for those farmers, they've got strong relationships with a lot of those individuals who've worked on them. And I know that you've been in contact with those individuals just to find out how they are, how their family are dealing. So I think we can't separate from, you know, the tragic human impact that people are feeling just now. In terms of Scottish food production, we're heavily dependent on seasonal workers coming into this country. It's too early in the season as yet to say exactly what the impact will be. We were expecting before the war in Ukraine, because of the policies on immigration that the UK government has put in place, that it would be difficult to source labour. And we only see the war in Ukraine making this issue even more difficult at this point of time. We know that there'll be, you know,
very unlikely to be any men from Ukraine who'll be able to come across to work here because of the restrictions that understandably have been put in place. There is concern that should any women from Ukraine come across here, they'll need some emotional support because, again, quite understandably, they'd be concerned about family that are back in Ukraine. And I know, speaking to the likes of RSABI and others, that the industry is looking to see what sort of help and support they could be put in place. So, in short, it's a bit early to tell, but we expect it'll be a really tough season. We know that if we look at the vegetable sector, for instance, individual growers there have already decided to cut back production between 15 and 25% because they have concerns about not being able to source labour. And if you're not able to source labour because of the high cost of production in those sectors, you're just not going to go through with that production schedule with that huge uncertainty to source. So I do think that both short term and long term, we really need to address the seasonal workers scheme for this country and see what we can do to encourage more workers in.
Thank you. Could I pose the question to Stephen Thompson, please?
Yeah, it's a really interesting, interesting is it's quite concerning. Dilemma that a lot of people have got. So Scott mentioned that the relationship with Ukraine and the high dependency on Ukraine for seasonal workers, it was pre-Brexit that dependency was on Bulgaria and Romanian workers. So the situation has changed because we used to source from within the EU. And then obviously leaving the EU, then those workers no longer came. We're now sourcing largely from Ukraine. So, and even with the seasonal worker scheme, there was an awful lot of field veg left in the field. People were losing an awful lot of their crop in the last 2 or 3 years. So pre-Ukraine, this has been a problem. And then with the war in Ukraine, it's just adding to the issue. And you know, we're talking about food security, and one of the things that we probably need to do more of in this country if we're wanting to address domestic production is grow more of our own veg and our own fruit sources. And it's the thing that we can't actually pick because we've not got a workforce. So we drastically need to try and work out solutions, either local solutions or more international solutions with regards to workforce or technological solutions. You know, there's talk that there's robotics now working in raspberries in Portugal. They're in an infancy, and they're not a short-term solution. And they're unlikely to be a long-term solution for some of the sectors. But these are big issues. And as I said, the farmers are businessmen here, and they're having to make really hard decisions with regards to what they put in the ground or what decisions they're making about, a cow that's going to calve in a year's time. These are decisions that they're making now that impact on future food production. And it'll be interesting to see what the spring plantings are with regards to some of the field veg this year. And that should be monitored very closely.
Thank you very much.
Could I just add as well, the thing that none of us have mentioned is the lack of workers in the processing sector as well, which is significantly impacting on throughput and ability to actually process, particularly in the livestock sector. But also, if you think about it, in the packing sector for potatoes, etc., all of these things are traditionally been done by overseas workers. And somehow we need to build an industry of workforce from local workers to try and fill that void.
Absolutely, thank you. But that's particularly true in the fish processing sector. Could I pose the question to Professor Alan Matthews, please?
I think on this particular question, I really don't have any expertise to offer. I think you've heard some very helpful insights from the previous speakers. So I'm going to pass, if I may, on this question.
No problem at all. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I know this will sound like a very premature request, but I'm already very aware that we're going to be tight for time. We've got quite a few questions to get through. Could I ask members to try and direct their questions at the panel member that they think they can most fully answer the question, and any of the panel members, if there's nothing covered, to indicate to come in, maybe to give their view, rather than us going through the whole panel. That would certainly help. Karen, did you have a further question just to finish off?
No, that's fine. I'll pass and let somebody else.
Thank you. A brief supplementary, Ariane Burgess.
Viner, yeah, I've got a supplementary on your situation of Ukrainian seasonal workers. So I'm going to direct this question to Scott Walker and then possibly Stephen Thompson as well. And you may not have an answer to this, but there was a recent Guardian article that reported that hundreds of Ukrainians are living and working informally in Britain after escaping from farms. Many claim to have been subjected to conditions of modern slavery. One Ukrainian, and I don't know if this is necessarily in Scotland, so I just want to say that. One Ukrainian woman explained that she worked on a cherry farm where they were not allowed to wear gloves, causing their hands to bleed and their skin to peel off. And she said, "I thought our rights would be well protected in the UK, but this has not happened." The article went on to explain that seasonal farm workers are not eligible for the two main government Ukrainian refugee schemes because they left the farms and weren't working on them, so they're kind of falling in a gap. So I'm just wondering what we can do to protect the rights of seasonal workers in general and give these Ukrainians who have left jobs as seasonal workers a swift and guaranteed route to staying legally in the UK. And I realise that might be out of the scope of your knowledge, but just interested to hear your responses on that.
Yes, thank you. So I've certainly never heard of any of those scenarios in Scotland at all. I know of individual farmers who have long-standing relationships with the Ukrainians and have made contact with them through the resettlement scheme to try and help and give them accommodation across here, not to provide work, but to provide accommodation, because there is a separation there. And it has proved very, very difficult, I think, to get all that connected. So I think that is something that does need to be simplified. As I understand it, and you touched on it, for those that come through that settlement scheme, they're not actually allowed to work on farms in Scotland or work in this country. And if that could be eased, I think that could be helpful. I think the farming sector as a whole in Scotland has a very, very good reputation for its seasonal workers. Most farms in Scotland rely on returning workers to a very high percentage, so it's not a new set of workers coming in each year. And I think if you look at the farms, you have an extremely high percentage of returning workers. That would indicate to me that the facilities on the farm, how they treat the workers, must be very good for those workers to return here in Scotland.
Thanks. Thank you very much, Scott, for your response. And it's really heartening to hear that there is a good relationship between farmers and that it isn't a one-off, that there is actually really a real relationship and not just transactional business approach. So actually, I'm complete there. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Scott, you're as well to stay on the screen because this is going to be entirely directed to yourself, and Stephen Thompson might want to pitch in. I'm just going to first of all touch on the impact of rising input costs, which we've already discovered or already talked about. What do we need to do to mitigate the rising costs, and do you see opportunities? And I'm specifically going to talk about a business that's in my constituency, Earnside Energy, and what they're doing is they're taking food waste and they're processing it down and they're turning it into liquid fertiliser, and farmers around me are actually using that product right now, and it's about 80% cheaper than trying to buy fert at current prices. So what are the opportunities? We also have the issue about slurry storage. We've got far too much slurry needing to be stored. So how can we take those two issues and turn them into opportunities?
Yeah. I raise really good points, Jim, and I think these would tend to be sort of what I put into the medium term category in terms of what the industry could do in medium term to move forward. So I start off, say, with renewable energy.
on farms. So a lot of farmers already have their own renewable energy generation on farm, whether that be wind turbines or solar panels. Now, the problem with that has often been connection to the grid and getting planning permission. So things that could be sped up to allow a greater investment in that area on farms to become more self-sufficient in energy would be helpful. In terms of fertiliser usage, there's a couple of things there that I think could be done with an immediate effect. I know that the Scottish Government have been looking at what's called the Track 1 of the National Test Programme, which would be looking at soil sampling on farms and nutrient management planning on farms. And I think the more information and help and assistance could be given in that area, that would allow farmers to use the nutrients that they currently have in the most efficient way possible and to the most appropriate way in the individual fields. I think that's a good thing. Another issue that we have found, certainly in the past, when we've looked at using non-traditional fertiliser usage, I would call it, is the attitude of the supply chain towards that. And, you know, some of the attitude of the supply chain, again, perfectly understandable, has been a bit resistance to use these, you know, non-chemical derivatives. So I think working as we have done, certainly ourselves in the past and others have done with the likes of SEPA, Food Standards Scotland, try and give that confidence to the supply chain to use these products would be helpful. And you touched on, Jim, what is a huge issue just now for us about the new rules on slurry storage that have just come in, and where farmers are facing, you know, very substantial investments to be put in place on farm. Now, those substantial investments, if actually put on farm, would allow slurry to be used, you know, better in some circumstances, but they don't actually make economic sense for a lot of farmers to do that. So some flexibility on those rules and some help with investment on farms to comply with those rules would help provide those long-term resilience measures.
An opportunity for collaboration on the use of slurry, though, Scott, not just having to use it on your own farm, but using it in your areas, so you've got small localities that are working together.
Yeah, and I think that's where we can look at machinery rings, we can look at small local cooperatives, we can look at bringing together farmers in groups to work in that area. You're looking at both investment in terms of storage, but also in terms of investment in kit of applying it to fields. So again, more that we can encourage and help support farmers to take those initiatives. I know there would be an appetite from a lot of people out there to do it. We're at a situation, unfortunately, that where a lot of these farms, the margins that they're experiencing just now is very low to non-existent, and therefore for them to make that investment is difficult, but also importantly is to give them the confidence to make that investment so that they see a long-term future for food production. And going back to what I said to the first question, I think it's that confidence issue within the industry that's a problem just now.
All right. Thank you, Scott.
I don't know. Did Steve indicate that? Have you got anything to add to that response, Steve? Stephen, beg your pardon.
Yeah. Sorry, I get called everything. So that's right. I suppose the key in all of this is kind of best practice. If we think about Track 1 in the Scottish Government terminology is trying to encourage farmers to baseline and understand what their soils are capable of. And one of the things that I think people will be looking at will be nitrogen use efficiency just now, how to get the best out of the inputs that they're trying to use. You're hearing stories that some farmers will not put fertilisers on some aspects or some parts of their land where you've got older grasses that perhaps are not going to convert that into sugars, etc. And also, if your pH is not right, then you're simply probably wasting quite a large proportion of your fertiliser. So people will be focusing in on that just now. With regards to the slurry question, of course, that's going to be tiered over quite a long period of time, up to 2026. So the biggest producers are going to take the hit on that first. So they're going to have meet the requirements first. So those investments at that level, you would hope quite a lot of them are already compliant with it, but it may need some throttle and assistance on those levels. I really like the idea of food waste and actually reconverting that into fertilisers, and I think there's some work ongoing on the use of food waste fertilisers and food waste into feed sector as well. Because we are an industry, or we are a society, we waste a phenomenal amount of food. You know, it's 30% of our greenhouse gas emissions come from our food wastage. And trying to address that, not only at a farm level, because there are efficiencies at farm level that probably every farm can make marginal gains. And one of the problems we have is we think of this industry as one thing, and we generalise all the time. And there's a huge variation in performance. And if we can actually bring those that are perhaps poorer performers or at the lower end of the technical efficiency scale up, then you'll start improving profitability across the board and reduce greenhouse gas emissions at the same time.
Thank you, Stephen. I'm going to bring in Rachel Hamilton for a brief supplementary on this theme before moving on to the next theme. Rachel.
Thanks, Convener. Scott, you mentioned rolling out track one of the national test programme, and also the NFUS had made a request to the Scottish Government to put towards greater funding to the Sustainable Agricultural Capital Grant Scheme. I wondered, first of all, what the hold-up was, and do you think it would be good for the Scottish Government or this committee to recommend to the Scottish Government that they replicate what has happened in the rest of the UK with their support to sustainable farming incentives such as paying farmers to plant nitrogen-fixing legumes or clover, etc., all the things that you know that are in that incentivisation.
Thank you. Yeah, there's a number of points there. So one, yeah, it would be very helpful for me, certainly, if the committee could encourage the Scottish Government to roll out the national test programme as a matter of urgency and get that launched and get farmers able to apply to it and take it up. I think that's hugely important. In terms of what's happening down south just now, I would give caution in terms of following the programmes that's happening down south, because the word that I'm getting back from fellow farmers down in England is that the direction of travel in England could jeopardise the productive capacity of agriculture. I think what we could actually learn more of is looking across the waters to Europe or to Ireland just now in terms of what they're doing to help the farming sector. So what they've broadly done is they've looked at land that's lying fallow just now to see how that could get put back into production. In France just now, they've just announced, but I don't have the details, but they've announced a fodder subsidy scheme, support scheme for a farming community to help with the fodder crisis that they expect the livestock sector to face. And the likes of Poland have recently announced a huge financial support to help with fertiliser production, and individual member states also are giving financial support to fertiliser plants to bring them back onto production and hopefully reduce the fertiliser prices. So I think that could all be done. And also I would encourage the Scottish Government to accelerate its plans for capital investment. So as you've touched on and the previous question touched on, looking at those investments in farm that could be done to increase productive capacity and increase efficiency in the farming business.
So just to come back on that, the Scottish Government, in the conversations that you've had, would be happy to suspend the EFAs as part of the greening requirements?
No, I'm very disappointed in the decision that we've had from the Scottish Government, which was to reject our call to suspend the EFA requirement and have a look at fallow land. I think that would have given a good boost to the sector,
and would have, you know, helped confidence to a degree, because it would have looked at us using the land that we have at our own disposal to increase predominantly be live animal feed. So I think that is something that should be looked at again. And also I would encourage looking at what incentives we could put in place to encourage greater protein planting in this country, because we are seeing through animal feed diets just now that the mix for animal feeds have had to be adjusted due to shortages, and they may continue the longer the war in Ukraine goes on.
Thank you.
Yeah, that wasn't really a supplementary, but Stephen Thompson has asked to respond to that question. Stephen.
Yeah, I suppose I come at it from a slightly different perspective than Scott. So on the EFA thing, I suppose, and one of my concerns is, and I've talked to an awful lot of farmers in through SAC consulting meetings over the last year, and one thing that they're all crying out for is confidence, and actually a signal of the long-term commitment to, in terms of policy. So they need to understand where policy is going. And of course, the discussions within Scottish Government are all about conditionality and actually delivering on biodiversity, on climate change, and on food production and people and the economy. And there is that trade-off. And unless farmers are aware of what the long-term future is, i.e., if those conditions are chimed with land available for biodiversity or EFAs, however they're defined, then maybe those production decisions would be different. There's also this issue, and I think from speaking with Scottish Government colleagues, that there was always concern that the EFA would just simply go into producing either more grain for whisky, or which obviously is an export revenue, or also for the feed sector. And the thing that got me has always been that we have not done our protein crop ecological focus area, the peas and beans aspect of it, particularly well because of our date. So the harvesting date has always been has gone against the grain for ecological focus areas, and it's different in England. They can harvest their crops, and we should have relaxed that particularly, because if we could have done that, that would have reduced long-term nitrogen use and also provided a protein supplement. And I think longer term, and Scott mentioned looking across the water, Northern Ireland have got a protein supplement that farmers can get a coupled support payment based on putting these types of crops in. And I think that's a long-term or medium-term solution that we might have to start thinking about. And the other thing is, all of this requires budget. And we know that in 2024, we don't have a commitment to budget long-term in agriculture. And that needs resolved pretty quickly, I think.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to the next theme. Alistair Allan.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if we could rewind slightly, and although we're talking about the impact of the war in the Ukraine, just look at the resilience of food production in Scotland prior to that shock. And I wonder if you could maybe say a little bit about the existing, if you like, food resilience, broken down perhaps a bit by sector if you can, and what the options are going forward now to try and strengthen that food resilience in Scotland. So those are probably questions that, well, many people might want to come in, but probably questions initially for Scott Walker and for Stephen Thompson.
Thank you. It's a very big question. I'll start off by saying to answer, and it's one that I suppose I start by looking at the relationship between farm production, the supply chain, and retailers, or I'll describe it as the lack of relationship that exists there in terms of long-term planning. So I would say, in general, before the war in Ukraine, the resilience within the sector was pretty low and pretty fragile. You know, we in Scotland have, say, a very good levels of food quality here. We've got, while Stephen's touched on it before, we've got a wide range of efficiency within the farming sector. We have a lot of farms who are very efficient and other farms who would like to be efficient, if more efficient, if the right systems were put in place. We've got, though, a very fragile processing sector in Scotland, where we rely on the farm output going to a very small handful of processors in Scotland. So when I look at, say, some of the greatest vulnerability for farming, it would be tend to be at that processing sector level, that if we were to lose certain processors, the option for where farm produce goes becomes very limited, very difficult, and tends to be more costly in terms of then shipping to the rest of the UK. So I think we're sitting at a stage where we need to sort of step back, have a look at where the key drivers are in each of the different supply chains and how we can support them. And I'll give just one example here, say in the egg sector, for instance, is we don't have a processing plant here in Scotland to deal with spent hens. Now, as the rules of transportation of animals become tighter and tighter and shorter, that will cause a severe problem for us here in Scotland. So strategically, we need to look at how we can help support and put in place a spent hen plant here in Scotland, because if we don't have that, we won't actually have an egg producing sector here in Scotland. So I use that as one example. And as another example, I'll just use the livestock sector or the beef trade, where we look at, you know, what's happening to beef prices and how do we actually get a domestic beef price that supports that long-term investment. And the very last point, I suppose, goes to the point that Stephen was making beforehand, is that people want to see the future direction that they're heading in. So what is that future direction of support, both from the government and also from the supply chain? And that's what's necessary to give the industry the confidence to continue to produce and to invest in the future. And if we don't get the right direction there, what we are going to see is a reduction in the productive capacity of the industry here in Scotland.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Stephen. Could I just remind everybody we're probably got about 40 minutes left in this session and there's still a lot of questions to be asked. Stephen, can I bring you in and then Elspeth?
Yeah, I'll try and be brief in this. So I fully agree with Scott in that we probably need to really think about strategic processing in this country and having strategic processing plants available. So if you think about the sheep meat sector, the vast majority of our, well, we don't kill cast ewes in Scotland. So mutton is entirely, they practically all go south of the border for slaughter. And about 55-60% of our lambs go south of the border for slaughter. So in terms of that resilience, we don't have it in Scotland, which then means that we're at the behest of other processors in terms of export opportunities, particularly into the Middle East countries and affluence there. And that may mean changes in our processing types and bringing in halal slaughter, looking at all of these in terms of opportunity. In terms of an individual farm level, I would say actually we've got an incredibly resilient industry, but that's largely driven by the fact that we've got agricultural support payments to underpin incomes. But also that farms are consistently becoming reliant on their off-farm income to underpin some of the activities in terms of food production, and also selling off plots of land that enable their non-profitable agricultural enterprises to keep going. So I've always said that farmers actually subsidise food production in some terms, because they are running loss-making enterprises because the market doesn't actually reflect the true price of food production. Yes, the dairy sector tends to work on that basis. It tends to work on a cost plus a very small margin basis. Hence the reason we've seen price increases in that sector very quickly. Global milk supplies are contracting. All of those kind of things are happening just now. But I do think we've got resilience in the sector in some instances.
Thank you. Elspeth MacDonald.
You can be now, and I'll try to be brief as I know we're under time pressure. I think there are many parallels in fishing with some of the things that my colleagues in the panel have been talking about here with regard to resilience. And I think certainly in fishing, we see that the resilience in some parts of our Scottish fleet have really been affected by the COVID pandemic. So the impacts of what we're seeing currently happening are exacerbating that. And I think I would echo also what Scott said about that point about confidence about business, for businesses to invest and to rebuild that resilience and to have resilience in our fishing industry for the future. And I think there's perhaps two things that I would highlight that I think are really important in terms of the policy landscape in Scotland that I think would help us to rebuild some of that resilience and to help to increase confidence that the industry could have for a bright future. One of these is around, I think, greater investment in fishery science. Everything we do in fisheries is very much driven by scientific catch advice that we feel increasingly doesn't reflect the way that our distribution of key commercial fish stocks is changing. And we would certainly want to see the Scottish Government making appropriate and necessary investment into fishery science to help support sustainable management of our stocks. And I think the other point I would make is one that I've possibly mentioned before at this committee around how we use our space at sea, better marine spatial planning. The fishing industry in Scotland is concerned about the long-term spatial constraints that we face through things like the expansion of offshore wind, through the development of a very extensive network of highly protected marine areas. Now, obviously, there has to be a balance between conservation, energy and food production. But at the moment, the spatial constraints that our industry faces are very extreme. And I think for the industry to help to rebuild that resilience, to help see a bright future and to help fishing businesses to have the confidence to invest in the industry for the future and to encourage new people into it, we need to have that confidence that we will have better marine spatial planning that will allow our industry to continue to operate profitably and to continue to make sure we have our domestic food production. Because yes, we must of course have energy security, but we must also have food security, and our fishing industry is a really important part of that. So I think these are some of the things I would like to see in the policy landscape that would really help our industry to rebuild that resilience. Thank you.
Mike has indicated he'd like to come in on this question.
Okay. Thanks so much, Convener. I think it's important here to try and distinguish how we're defining resilience, because the question was about the resilience of production systems. And what concerns me is that we need to have a long-term strategic view on what constitutes a resilient food system. At the moment, we operate a just-in-time system, whereas actually what we really need is a just-in-case system to account for the sorts of eventualities that we're facing at the moment, for example, off the back of COVID, the war in Ukraine, and looking forward to the long term is the impacts of climate change. And I'm just concerned that the sort of responses we've had at the moment are about maintaining the status quo of the food system, whereas actually what we really need to be thinking about is a transformation of the food system to give it the flexibility so that it can cope with future shocks, because we know that those are going to occur from biodiversity loss, from climate change impacts. So I think we need to be careful not to get caught in the trap of what needs to happen now in response to the current situation and not lose sight of what needs to happen in terms of food system transformations for the wider scale shocks that are likely to occur. Just as a point, the first thing I did when the food security issue first arose was check out what was happening with the El Nino La Nina cycles. And fortunately, at the moment, we're in a relatively stable situation. But if next year, for the next growing season, there is a severe El Nino development, it will have severe impacts in terms of global food production. And myself and colleagues over the years have always warned of the increasing probability of multiple and coinciding shocks, be it from war or from climate change impacts. So I think we need to have a really careful view on what's likely to happen next year in terms of some of the world climate teleconnections. Thank you.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Can you just briefly, a number of people have mentioned there the importance of the supply chain and preparing it for the future. I wonder if Professor Matthews could offer any observations either about or from Ireland about what differs or if anything differs in the way in which he sees Scotland and Ireland preparing for the future in that respect. I'm thinking specifically in terms of the supply chain and making it more resilient.
I guess one of the points of similarity with the two agricultural economies is that we are both highly export-oriented. So although a lot of people would interpret resilience in terms of doing more ourselves and emphasising local food production, certainly for an agricultural economy like Ireland, that really doesn't make a lot of sense. We are always going to be highly dependent on exporting our food off the island. So that, I suppose, tends to focus attention on trying to create as stable an international framework as possible. That's obviously come under huge stress and strain with the invasion in Ukraine. What we see at the moment is a domino effect where because of the initial shock and the increase in global prices, countries are now introducing, if you like, beggar my neighbour type of policies where they are trying to protect their own domestic consumers by putting export bans and export restrictions in place. And of course, that's just amplifying the upward trend. So trying to avoid those kinds of beggar my neighbour responses for an exporting country like Ireland, I think is hugely important. We are, of course, still very much subject to the common agricultural policy, and the direction of travel there, as I think also in Scotland, is to try to focus on better integrating these environmental, biodiversity and climate impacts of production into farmer decision making. And I think probably in answer to your question, I would sort of encourage the committee to think of ways in which, indeed, despite the obvious costs of higher production input costs in particular, but it does provide incentives and an opportunity to maybe accelerate some of the changes which are indeed part of government policy. As Stephen has mentioned, for example, trying to improve nitrogen use efficiency on farms, which is a win-win for farmers. It reduces costs and also reduces greenhouse gas emissions and reliance on imported fertilisers. So my sense is to try to think of ways in which we can turn this situation into one where we can, in fact, accelerate some of the necessary changes which Mike has already referred to.
Thank you.
Just staying with you, Professor Matthews, it's interesting. I'm glad you touched on, you know, this whole crisis might accelerate the direction travel that we recognised we were going to have to take anyway. It's a bit like COVID forcing more people to engage with the medical profession and a more triage system. So you had to remotely speak to your GP, and it accelerated that direction travel anyway. So it's interesting you've touched on that. It's a bit like an ill wind. It may actually drive improvements that were needed to be done over a shorter space of time. But my question is to you, with your experience on a more European scale, is In France, they appear to be taking this... Well, we are taking it seriously, but in France, it's been taken incredibly seriously. And, you know, there's almost panic about the food shortages that they might see in France. Are we taking this crisis seriously enough in Scotland and the UK?
I think the real food security crisis is going to be in, well, Ukraine itself, of course, with the displaced millions of people there, but also in the low-income countries, particularly around the Mediterranean basin, North Africa, and elsewhere in Africa. For us in Europe, and I think also in Scotland, I would very much, I'd be very reluctant to use the term food security crisis. There will be an increasing food affordability crisis for some low-income households, because as some other participants have mentioned, we are seeing increasing food price inflation. So there are, you know, many households who are running into difficulties, but we know the solution to that is indeed to provide additional direct income support to those households. It's not really an agricultural market problem. It's a social policy issue. So the crisis, and you know, Scott made this clear at the very outset, is not a food crisis, it's an animal feed crisis within Europe. It's high animal feed costs putting pressure particularly on the intensive livestock sectors. But I think we need to put that into perspective. It's certainly not threatening a generalised food security crisis in my view at this point in time.
Thank you.
Obviously, as we move, if I may just make one further, as we move from this particular growing season into the next, I mean, there are these warning lights around fertiliser availability. You've seen already the news today where Russia is threatening to turn off natural gas supplies to Poland and to Bulgaria. And that could indeed extend to other European countries. And although we produce around 90% of our fertilisers domestically within Europe, of course, a lot of that is dependent on imported natural gas from Russia. So there are these threats that we need to keep in mind, but I would still be slow to use the term sort of generalised food security crisis arising from the Ukraine war. Thank you.
Thank you. That's most useful. Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. I'm very quickly going to touch on something that Scott said, rolling back on the EFAs. I would just caution rolling back on EFAs from a reputational damage point of view, because it certainly won't go down well right across the other sectors of the country. But there's also the point about farmers already plant huge volumes of legumes as it is. The problem is we then batter 400 or 500 weight of nitrogen over the top of it and kill the clover out of our grass. So there's a shift in behaviour that would also help us here. But I'm going to touch more on the vulnerability of the wider supply chain. And Scott, you talked about this earlier on, the conversations or lack of conversations with supermarkets and the role of the supermarkets ombudsman. Surely supermarkets, being they supply 90% of our groceries in this country, they've got a role to play in making sure we maintain resilience in our food supply system in this country. And does it concern you that Lord Frost tweeted the other day there that the best thing to do is to reduce tariffs on imported goods, not just the ones we can't grow, but all the products that we can grow, including beef and lamb in this country, and just bring it in from somewhere abroad?
Two things there. So first of all, so I replied to Lord Frost's tweet yesterday. I won't say here what I said, but yeah, hugely concerning. And I think it's a huge degree of naivety being shown there, that the way to solve the problem is to ramp up standards in this country, yet open the doors and allow anything to come into this country, regardless of the standards. That one just seems fundamentally wrong. But secondly, I think there's a huge question mark that if you base the whole food security of the UK on the basis that we can source from anywhere abroad at any time, regardless of what else happens. You're putting a lot of trust in a system that we've saw just over the war in Ukraine has come, you know, basically, I'm not saying crashing down, because it's not crashing down as yet, but it's being strained to the limit. So I don't believe we'll be in a position where we can just source whatever we want and outbid everyone in the future for it. And some of the other commentators have commented on the fact of we've got one crisis just now, but we could easily see a drought in America come about or a flood in America come about. We saw a few years ago countries put in place export bans on food, which in essence gave rise to the uprisings we saw in the Middle East and in Egypt. So it's a very volatile situation. Going back, though, to retailers, in my view, I still go back to governments can do a lot, and governments can do a lot more, I do think. I think just sitting and waiting to hope everything pans out OK is not the right strategy. But ultimately, the retailers have huge, huge power here and could make such a big difference. And I'm not seeing them do that at this point of time. If we use Brexit as an example, I'd give the retailers credit where credit is due. They saw that Brexit was going to cause a huge disruption to them being able to source product. And they did everything possible at that point of time to secure their domestic food supply, you know, to basically buy up what they could buy up and ensure that there'd be plenty of product on the shelf. We're seeing a situation now that across every area of production, costs are increasing. But there's a huge resistance in terms of the retailers, in my view, to one, recognise that and to pay the appropriate price for food and to pay a fair price throughout the supply chain. But I think it is an area that should be looked at far more closely. Contracts should be considered as to what's appropriate and what's not appropriate. And retailers could have a huge amount of strength to secure their processing capacity within this country and to give the right encouragement to increase food production.
Yeah, so the point of we can't chuck the baby out with the bathwater. We're on this course to try and tackle net zero, and we all accept that it's going to be an issue. So the processing facilities that we've got in this country, my belief is that we need to increase that, because cattle and sheep travelling south on the hoof take up a lot more room and a lot more lorries than if they're travelling down on the hook. And surely we've got to be able to do the processing in this country and then export the product. I think it was Stephen who said we should be doing a just-in-case rather than a just-in-time. Would you see that there's value in us trying to invest in those areas?
Yes, I would. And again, just for clarity for the committee, so the committee understands where I'm coming from, is I don't see at all in anything I'm suggesting that we abandon our net zero targets. You know, I think reducing the carbon footprint of farming is important, and it's something that we're committed to, and it ties in with everything that we need to do at this point in time. But this just relying upon just-in-time isn't working. You know, we've got to build that resilience within the supply chain. We've got to drive efficiency on the farm. We've got to look at improvements on the farm. We need more processing here in Scotland that allows us to do this and ultimately allows us then to also export abroad. And sorry, just one other bit to add, and going back to the point that I talked about resilience earlier on. I think we've got to look at some of the infrastructure we have in Scotland. So, say the port systems, for instance, we saw during Brexit and recently that one of the big issues was just actually having enough containers here in Scotland and enough freezer containers and electricity points at the port system so that you could store the product to get on the ships to go to Rotterdam and then put on bigger ships to go elsewhere. So these are the sort of pressure points that we've got to look at in terms of building resilience and profitability, ultimately, within the food system here in Scotland.
Can I bring in Stephen Thompson?
Yeah, just building on what Scott was saying there, really, is that I always remember the Icelandic volcano crisis where flights were stopped and suddenly we were at like half a day short of running out of food from the shelves, fresh food. And we changed the rules very quickly to allow food to fly in. We haven't learned. We haven't learned from that. That's what, 12 years, 13 years ago, I think, if I remember rightly. And then you look at the Suez, the ship stuck in the Suez and the problems that, that led to. We don't seem to learn from issues that are happening. And Mike Rivington's point was absolutely right, is that we need to look at the resilience of our food systems in terms of geopolitics, but also in terms of climate. And I don't know if anybody's really considering long-term food security with climate change and extreme weather events. I mean, you just have to look at the flooding in Australia just now to see that actually La Nina is actually having an impact on some aspects of their production systems. And then we forget the sheer buying power that likes of China have in terms of buying protein, in terms of buying crops, in terms of buying and securing natural resources for long-term food production for their economy. And I don't think we're really, really focusing that. And if we go back to pre-Brexit or pre-EU exit, as I keep getting told to call it, pre-EU exit, DEFRA initially announced a zero tariff system. And then the long-term impact on our agriculture sector would decimate it, because we cannot compete with some of the lower cost production systems. And if you reduce those tariffs, people can still meet our standards. So Australian beef, 60% of it's grass or something. It's not hormone treated. It meets our standards. So they can export to us on a low cost basis. And we know that retailers will source cheap product. Consumers will buy cheap product. Even though they say they want to purchase British, when it comes to the purchase decision, an awful lot of households buy on price.
Commissioner, sorry, is that where the Commissioner then has to have more teeth?
I think so, yes. I think we really need a long-term look at food production global. We need to look at it in a global context. Myself and Alan Rennick and others did a report for Oxford Farming Conference 2013 on power in agriculture, and I was shocked when we did that at how certain aspects are so concentrated it's quite scary at a global scale. And we need to revisit these things and actually look at where the pinch points with regards to things like phosphates, fertiliser supplies, things that were absolutely required in the long term running. And then work out how we basically work a system where we're not reliant on a very few number of processors that have got that are reliant on five major supermarkets who control everything.
Thank you. This is the 20-minute warning to both members and panel members. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, convener, and maybe this will be quick because I think we've started to touch on, I've started to get responses to this question already anyway, but how can we address the simultaneous challenges of high production costs with risk to producing sectors and the rising cost of food with risks to food security of low-income groups? And Professor Alan Matthews, you mentioned additional income support, but can I ask yourself if you've got any other thoughts on that, and then also bring in Scott and Stephen on that question?
If that question was directed to me, in terms of the consumer support, I mean, clearly governments, and I'm not fully au fait, obviously, with the recent steps the UK government has taken, but European governments have stepped in to help households with higher energy costs, for example, which have risen perhaps higher than food prices over the recent months. My concern would be that some of the interventions seem to, in a sense, hold existing consumption patterns in place when clearly we do need to try to encourage change. We do want households to save on energy. We do want them to move away from using as much petrol in their cars as they do at present. So, you know, lowering, for example, the cost of energy it seems to work against that particular goal. So I think if we use that as an analogy for the food system, the approach should perhaps not be to try to make food cheaper by subsidizing food per se, but rather by increasing the purchasing power of households to make up for those higher costs, but leaving it to households to make their purchasing decisions in the light of the fact that food is now more expensive because of these higher input costs.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Scott?
Yes, thank you. Probably outside my area of expertise, but just a few general comments, because I think the average consumer is going to have a very, very tough time over the remainder of this year certainly. And I think, you know, government help and support aimed at those people in society who face, you know, unprecedented increases in costs. I think the World Bank said, you know, this is the biggest price shock we've saw in 50 years. In terms of some practical things that I think could be done, I know over the course of time we've been working with food banks and different charities as to how you could redirect farm produce and produce within the processed sector into food banks to help, you know, people. And again, I know that sometimes that's to do with packaging and rules, because you know, for instance, you know, accepting meat is often difficult. So I think that's an area that could be looked at, and what sort of help and assistance could make to that function. And often it's a bit of an organisational thing, you know, getting somebody in place to simply make those connections and make that happen. So this product there, I know there's also some education that is useful in terms of how people use different products, how you make the most of what you currently do have, you know, how you cook meals instead of it all having to be processed products. As I say, slightly outside my area of expertise, but there's a few things. The other thing, though, going back to specifically the farming sector, I do think medium term, this, though, is about maintaining our capacity here within Scotland to produce food, not just for the Scottish market, but or also the UK market, because I think if you have that domestic production, that is helpful rather than relying upon imports, which undoubtedly are just going to, you know, rise in price. So having some domestic production here to underpin, I think, is hugely important. Thank you.
Thank you. And Stephen, if you have anything to add, but it's fine if you don't.
Yeah, I would just probably add that I mean, the food banks are one way that we seem to be overcoming some of these issues. But I mean, if you look to the United States, and they've got food assistance programs where you're actually subsidising the consumer rather than the producer. And these are real alternatives that we've never really considered in this country, or probably in Europe, where we always think that supporting the producer is the easiest way to do these things, to maintain food production, or food prices at or subsidise food production and food prices. So there are alternative models out there, but it takes an awful lot of or a long-term vision for governments and a leap of faith to actually do these things. But these could be looked at alongside income support, sort of the mainstream income support measures. And in America, I think it's based on the minimum nutritional standards that a household should be able to afford.
Thank you for those responses. That's very interesting. I guess what underlies for me, though, is maybe we need to be looking at better paying jobs and, you know, more security in that way as well, so that people actually have more money in their pocket from the job that they're actually doing, so they can afford the good food that's being produced in Scotland. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Absolutely. I think that probably should have been considered as part of the Good Food Nation Bill that we're working through at the moment. So thank you for that, Stephen. That's helpful. Move on to questions from Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. My questions are probably for Scotland and Elspeth. So Mike's already referenced that, you know, sort of long term we need to be looking at transformation of the whole food system. And Professor Matthews has mentioned acceleration of the direction of travel. So looking at medium to long-term needs and increasing domestic food production resilience, is there anything else you'd like to flag that hasn't already been mentioned? Any thoughts on the ongoing reforms of the agriculture and fisheries policies, for example? And for Elspeth, I had the pleasure recently of visiting the new Lerwick fish market and saw firsthand the fantastic variety and high-quality fish that was being landed. But much of the fish caught in UK waters is export, while fish eaten in the UK is imported. So when looking at future food security and recognising what you've said about spatial planning at sea, what role does the domestic fishing industry play?
Can I maybe go to Elspeth to kick off on that one so it's fresh in her mind, then we'll come back to Scott. Elspeth.
Sure, thank you. I think that's a very interesting point you raise about we export a lot of what we catch and import a lot of what we eat. So there is lots of fish consumed in Scotland and in the UK, but it's often things that we don't catch here. And of course, what we catch here is constrained by what's in our waters. And I think also, you know, that's largely driven by consumer preferences. Some of the things that we catch, there isn't a demand for here. They haven't traditionally been eaten. They have been more traditionally eaten in export markets and vice versa. But I think some of the things that we've been talking about as this discussion has gone on in terms of, you know, how the food system might have to be transformed in terms of perhaps consumption being closer perhaps to the point of production. I do apologise if there's noise in the background. I'm sitting in a hotel and there seems to be some construction going on behind me. Sorry if it's noisy. I think this comes down to this wider food system transformation in terms of will people, will the food system perhaps either persuade or drive people to more consumption of domestically produced product rather than exporting a lot of what we produce to elsewhere. I mean, for some of our exported product, the market is still quite close to home. You know, it is just into the EU, into places like France and Spain. The carbon footprint of that is still relatively small. Obviously, some other products are going further afield. So I think there's a lot there in terms of not necessarily perhaps things that industry can drive to change that, but actually about how consumers and how the public start to see their role in food transformation and the purchasing decisions that they make. I think certainly we would hope to see some of the policies coming forward from government around fisheries to support our industry in terms of its continued production of climate smart food, low carbon footprint fisheries. We have, and this committee has discussed the joint fishery statement that the four administrations are working on. I think Scottish Fishermen's Federation has some reservations about how that's going to support I think this is the right policies that the industry needs to, as I say, continue to make the right contribution to our climate smart food production going forward. And it's early days with that. There's a lot still to flow from it. There's a lot both in the domestic policy landscape that we will be engaging with to again just try to make sure that we've got a domestic landscape that allows our industry to continue to produce this climate smart food, and that growing that demand, I think, in the UK for domestically caught product. We know that sea fish and other bodies are are working hard to try and get more UK-produced fish into UK retail, for example. So I think there's a lot that we can do in the industry, but I think, too, that a lot of what that future looks like will be driven by the consumer role in terms of their purchasing decisions and their role in that food system transformation.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. Scott, can Scott got anything to say?
Yeah, briefly, Scott.
Yeah, three things I would highlight. So one of the things that we'd like to see put in place is by the government is some sort of food security impact assessment on all future legislation, so that there was a clear understanding of what that legislation would mean in terms of the food security impact in costs. I think that would be helpful and would focus people's minds. Second bit, going on to about future support systems, this isn't actually a debate about production or the environment, which sometimes it's stylised as. I think you can have both. And if you go out on many Scottish farms, you see both working, you know, wonderfully, fantastically in partnership. We had a lot of work being done so far in Scotland through, first and foremost, the farmer-led groups looking at an agriculture policy that would be appropriate for Scotland, that has food production at the centre of it, but also, very importantly, actually delivers by climate change targets and delivers by biodiversity. That has now been taken on by the AREOB group that is set up. So what I would like to see is that coming to fruition as soon as possible, so that there's that direction of travel that's there. Very much, I think it is about putting production at the centre, but also ensuring that we continue to deliver and we accelerate the pace of delivering on climate change targets and enhancing biodiversity. I think all three can happen exactly the same time, but we need to make those choices and we need to set that direction of travel to give that confidence back to the industry.
Thank you, Scott. Sorry, I'll just stop you there. I'm going to move to a supplementary on this from Alistair Allen, then Rachel Hamilton.
My question was intended to be about unusual species, as it were.
Yeah, that's absolutely. Fine, yeah. I think that ties
unusual,
in. Yeah.
I say unusual. We've just had a discussion about grey lag geese. So in terms of food resilience, I don't know if you listened in, we were talking about creating a potential market for grey lag geese, given their prevalence on the west coast of Scotland. But there's also a question, I suppose, about species like venison. Why is it that the UK appears to be a net importer of venison? I don't pretend that those two species are ever going to make us a food resilient nation, but there may be other examples, and I just wondered if you had a view on them. Anyone who wants to go first on that, but
are you going, Scott?
Scott, very briefly, and then Scott Walker, Stephen.
Yeah. In terms of geese, generally speaking, to my membership, we see geese as a pest, which are destroying crops and underpinning, doing damage to food production. I'm sure there'd be some sort of market for geese, but I don't see that as being a solution. In terms of venison production, there are a number of farms in Scotland where the market opportunities exist. I think it could grow in the future.
Stephen.
Yeah, I mean, I did listen in, and I was probably smirking a bit when we were talking about geese and dating markets for that. It'd probably be a very niche market. There probably is a market for these kind of things. But generally, if you start looking at the trends in terms of consumption, this is where carcass balancing comes in, is that we export, you know, if you look at our import-export statistics, we export a lot of sheep meat. But it's whole carcasses, it's awful. And then we're importing legs and chops and things like that. Our consumer, and it's a point I raised in the comment, is the consumer seems to be very picky, and we've lost this connection with actually some types of food. Wild venison, we export wild venison into Germany and things like that. No, we don't seem to have a penchant for for these types of products anymore because they're gamey. They taste different. And part of it is that we're breeding poultry that's probably pretty tasteless, so that you can put it in a sauce and have a product that way. So, you know, it's reconnecting people with food is a vital component of that, and that's education. That takes a long, long process to do so. But there'll be a niche market for some of these things.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Okay, it's a question for Scott. Just it's a supplemental to the previous one. So you were talking there about the food security impact assessment, which you'd like to see. So to ensure that agricultural land is prioritised to address this food insecurity that we're experiencing, does that mean that there should be a moratorium on applications of large-scale forestry that are bought by non-agricultural businesses to offset carbon?
In short, yes. I could expand more, but overwhelmingly, yes, there's huge concerns amongst the farming community just about the amount of non-agricultural money that's coming in to buy up, you know, big areas of Scotland to offset the carbon emissions elsewhere. I just feel that is fundamentally wrong. We should be using this land here in Scotland, first and foremost, looking at our own carbon emissions and what we do with that, rather than looking at foreign money coming in and stopping what would be agricultural production.
Thank you. That's probably a good note almost to stop on. And I did have a question based almost on that. It was to let Mike Rivington back in. Just a brief response. Do we need to accelerate how we look at land use, given the land use pressures? Just heard about additional planting, a bit more extensive farming, and we've also heard from Elspeth about the pressures in the sea that's available. Do we need to accelerate what we do with our land use strategy to ensure that food resilience is addressed as well as climate change?
Yeah, thanks, Kevin. I think, yes, we do. I think this is a very serious issue, given the sort of drivers and pressures. But what I would like to point out is how little improved agricultural land is actually used directly for human food. It's about 1.5%, and yet about 74% is used for livestock feed, for input into cattle or to bottles. And again, I want to sort of just flag that we need to define food security more carefully. We have a situation where globally an area the size of China is used for food production that is wasted. So in terms of developing a land use strategy for Scotland, we need to think about what would we really mean in terms of food security rather than the resilience and sustainability of the food system itself and the businesses concerned with it. And back at what Scott was saying is that, yes, there are huge opportunities for achieving the multiple targets of food security, reduced emissions and enhanced biodiversity. But I think we have to be realistic as well as actually looking at how land use across the whole of Scotland, indeed the whole of the UK, is used in terms of then providing enough food for the population. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just for the record, can you tell us what percentage of improved agricultural land is not used directly to feed humans? We missed that figure. It was the figure you quoted at the start.
Okay, so the figure that I have is crops grown directly for human use account for 1.5% of all Scottish agricultural land, and that's 4.4% of the improved agricultural land.
Thank you very much. I thank all your members. As always, these sessions are fascinating. We always run out of time, but thank you very much. That's very useful, and we'll play a part in our work moving forward. I now formally close this meeting, and in the meeting we'll move into private. Thank you.